Seem like the whole city go against me. Every time I'm in the street, I hear yak, 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 yak. Men down.
All right, all right, all right, all right. Welcome back, Plague House Bubble. This is your commissioner, Isaac Schumacher, and this is my trusty cohort from the Med City side, Mr. Isaac Janes. How we doing?
Fantastic. Welcome back to the room. Welcome back to, as you said, home base.
Home base.
We're here.
Yeah, we tried to fit into my closet, but it was not big enough to hold our egos. So we brought it back into here, which is good. We have room to breathe.
Heads. You see the heads.
Why are they big?
Two big heads.
It's ridiculous. But we are here to bring you some fantastic basketball content as we finished up with the interleague play. Congratulations, Spamtown, once again for getting the job done.
Congratulations, Spamtown, from all of us at Med City. We're tied 1-1 now. So
we are. We are.
Is going to be a big one,
and we still are behind in the overall rankings. So next year we're just going to have to do it again to prove that we're the best. But
yes,
as far as this goes, we're here to bring you some content to wrap up into the playoffs and also give those four teams that are likely not going to make the playoffs some flowers. And a little synopsis going into next year for them. So without further ado, we're about to present our power rankings for you. And we broke them up into three kind of staggered sections. As you can see, we're a very we're a fragmented league right now. We have the four teams at the bottom out of the playoffs. We have the four teams at 7-5. And then we have the four teams at 9-3. So we broke them up just like that for you. We're going to start with the teams not in the playoffs. Here they are right now. At number four, we have the Ghost of Simmons. At number three, we have the Heroes of Hermantown. At number two, the Fire Nation of Frederickstad. And number one, Stephen A's Fighting Kwames. Janes, any large brushstrokes as you see this right here?
Well, I think preseason, you could probably make a case that three of these four teams would be in this tier, and it would make sense. The one that really, really sticks out, how is Elliot Newman in this tier? And it comes down to a similar reason why Kevin's here, injuries. And that's why, you know, Spamtown ended up, you know, at the last 3 weeks of interleague play, you're winning 4 out of 6 matchups, even though, stat from your report a couple days ago, Med City's outscored Spamtown in the last 3 weeks, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
But Spamtown still ends up 4-2 because of, really specifically, those two squads. And it's not anything on Elliot and Kevin. It's because their teams have been so, so hurt.
Mm-hmm.
The Fire Nation specifically. So that's why you get three of these bottom four teams are from Med City. That's why it'd be like that sometimes.
It does.
And it hit Elliot. Of course it did.
All three of the Med City teams in this category do have an identity to them, so
I
don't expect them to be out of the game too long. Next season, they'll be back, and they'll be winning more than a combined 6 games. No doubt. And so we're going to break everyone down for you. So starting with the number 12-ranked Ghost of Simmons,
mm-hmm.
I'm about to explain my latest development in the nerd department here. We put together a depth chart. And so I'm going to try to explain this as reasonably as I can. And James, you can help me out because he's heard me explain it once before.
Yes, I have.
So what I have done is I have broken up everyone, every player into their primary position. So, of course, some players have dual eligibility. They're only going to be categorized into the position in which they are primarily situated in. So, like, for example, DeJounte Murray is a 1-2. He's a primary point guard, so he's going to be slotted into that spot, and so on and so forth. So what I did here, as you can see, this is called the perfect roster. The top six of each position is in green and bolded. The next six after that is green unbolded, and then so on and so forth. It's broken up into six each: green bolded, non bolded, yellow bolded, non bolded, red bolded, non bolded, and then those that don't have a color are outside of the top 36 for that position. And so what we get is this nice looking ice cream sandwich of a chart. And what we have here, and what I've figured out, is that all of the major talent is kind of, you can find them on the outside in either the one with the point guard spot or the five with the center spot. So you want to try to stack your cards in those two positions if you can, because those are the players that end up getting you the most points. Of course, you need the other positions as well, so they matter just as much. They just matter a little less. And so you see here, the average positions for those two outside position are the average grade for those two outside positions are much higher than the ones in the middle. Power forwards, they are a bit heavier than the two threes as far as the top end talent goes. And then you get this abundance of really kind of C-grade shooting guards. And then small forwards is by far your weakest position. And so you need a small forward, but you don't want to see a lot of your star talent stacked up in that small forward position, because that odds are it means that you're not producing as many points as you could be, so to say. So also, you're going to see that some players have an arrow next to them. If they have an arrow next to their name, that means that they have dual eligibility. If they are in red, if they are in red font, that means that they are inserted into a position that is not their primary position. So for example, one player on this list that is not in their primary position is Caris LeVert. Caris LeVert is a primary shooting guard. You're going to see him in red because he is aligned in the small forward position on his depth chart. And what that means then is that Caris LeVert he's just out of his main position, but it matters because Caris LeVert is generally a shooting guard, which generates more points than a small forward. So you see here, I say that any player that is in red in that small forward position, that's a good thing for you. That's a great thing for you, because that means that you have moved a player that normally generates more points into that position that generates less points in that small forward spot. And so that's a good thing. If you see any red arrows pointing outside, that is also a good thing. That means that that player has been moved from the outside in, and so that's also good. It's the same kind of idea.
He came from the category that it's pointing at.
Right. He came from the category that it's pointing at. That's correct. If he's in red. And then if he's in black, then he's just eligible for that category that he's pointing at. So I confused myself explaining this out loud, so just bear with me. You're going to be all right. It's not too hard of a concept, really.
Listen to it a couple times, just kind of take a breath, but it's there. It's there.
So
I heard the explanation, yeah. And it ended up making sense. I swear to you.
Red pointing in, bad. Red pointing out, good. Black pointing in is nice, because you can just move your player there if you need them. Black pointing out is very, very nice. Oh, no, I'm sorry. Inside pointing black is very nice because you can move a player from the outside in. And then obviously just any player pointing out is good because you can just put them there if you need to. Anyway, I'm done explaining it. We're going to pull up a chart. So here's Hunter's team. As you can see, it's a little different than the perfect roster I showed you. Unfortunately for Hunter, he wasn't able to get a lot of his players color-coded. His biggest products are Damian Lillard, Zach LaVine, and Andrew Wiggins. And those are his only three players that made the top 12 in any of the positions. Kawhi Leonard and Ben Simmons obviously didn't play either. Neither of them played this year. So going forward, Hunter will at least have a power forward in Kawhi Leonard to have. Probably is going to be Green. I would assume that Kawhi Leonard is going to be Green again. Josh Giddey, obviously a really young talent that's improving. Alex Caruso has been a nice surprise this year. But outside of that, this team is not that young and not that good. And so it's hard to say where exactly Hunter is supposed to go with his team next year. I think he just takes all the top talent he can get and flushes the rest away. Other than Bol Bol, keep Bol Bol as your spirit animal, man. That's someone you'd like to see. Bones Highland as well. But everyone else on this list is kind of deplorable. I don't know. What do you think, James?
The thing that I'm interested in the most here, because obviously, like, Hunter's going to come out of this season. If there's one thing to take away, it's that Josh Giddey was a great, great pick last season.
He was a great pick.
We kind of turned some heads a little bit, especially with Mobley on the board, looking at the power forward spot for this team. That'd be a great fit for Mobley because Kevon Looney is your best power forward right now. But Josh Giddey's performed really well. But there's a bunch of extra point guards here. So I know it's specified in the trade that I cannot get this player at all, ever, apparently. But I think the biggest thing for me, what's Damian Lillard's trade value moving forward? And can he be shipped off for maybe some younger pieces? Because he is obviously an incredibly talented basketball player. Eventually, Ben Simmons will, we think, come back to play basketball. So the point guard spot is really the one thing that's solidified here. So I would, if I was Hunter, I would consider taking one of those guys, probably preferably Damian Lillard, the oldest of the three, and looking to try and ship him off somewhere else to get some younger pieces. There are pieces here. You can build around a guy like Zach LaVine. You can kind of build around a guy like Andrew Wiggins, but you need some more depth around.
They're young
enough.
It's
a long way to go.
Wiggins is a good guy to have at your three because it's not as important. But definitely need big men. Big men is the biggest void on this team. Not a single four or five that you can rely on.
Lillard for a big man would be big, especially with, you know, a huge 3-4 in Kawhi.
It would be big. There's plenty. We're going to break everyone down, so we'll get to see who has all the big men and whatnot. But we're going to move on.
They're not here.
So the next team on the list is the Hermantown Heroes of Mr. Kevin Andrews. And this team has a pretty good-looking chart, I'm not going to lie, especially after all the trades that Kevin has gone through this year. He kind of did a little ring around the rosy. Because he started with OG, traded him for De'Aaron Fox, who he didn't necessarily need because he's very point guard heavy. He has a total of 17 guards on his team.
Jesus.
17. I mean, like a total of, yeah, I mean, like, oh, there's the numbers right there. It's not exactly 17 guys, but it's 17 slots he could work with in that guard position. And I'm not even sure he has 17 total slots to play with in all three of the rest of the categories combined. So that was a big move that he had to make to get another 3-4 back in the mix, and Kyle Kuzma is a great option for that. I actually think he might actually have more upside right now than OG just because he's healthy like all the time, and he's $1. I mean, so like that's a great move going forward. He's got his two big men in Bam and Christian Wood. There's a lot of versatility on this team. So, Med City in general is kind of, they like having a lot of pure players that don't have the dual eligibility, but Kevin does have quite a bit of dual eligibility here. He gets a young other guard in De'Anthony Melton, which should be nice going forward. And then, yeah, a lot of good young talent that you can work with, and then Steph Curry. And so Kevin has three first-round picks in this next draft as well. If anyone should be worried, it's not Kevin, because I think he's in great shape. And so I'm really happy and proud of how he handled his team this year, honestly.
I'm hoping that he takes the initiative to, shove the team in one direction or the other. Because I think you can go one of two ways. You can either trade some bigger pieces in the off season and really, really load up on a ton of futures and become the Oklahoma City Thunder of this league. Or you have three first-round picks. You can package that with some of the younger talent and go get some good guys for right now. Kevin can do whatever he wants. I just want to see him do something with it.
It will be interesting. There might be a trade you could make with Hunter, even, because Hunter is obviously going to have to do something, and he doesn't have a lot of trade appeal, and so maybe there's Kevin can flip a few or all of his first-round picks for a Damian Lillard, who knows?
But injuries hit that team hard, too.
They did. I mean, that is the reason why he only has two wins this year, because he was dealing with a lot of that as he was transitioning with his team. And so there wasn't a whole lot of opportunities for Kevin to bounce into the mix this year. But that's all right, dude. You're fine. Don't worry about it. You won the football championship anyway. Who cares? Moving on, then, the Fire Nation of Fredrikstad is the next on the list. And this is another team that the depth chart isn't as pretty as Kevin's might be, but holy cow, man. I mean, Jared Vanderbilt, enough said. This team doesn't have the big men, but it will. Like, I don't know how high Vandy can climb, but he... I would love to see it. If he's not going to do it, then OG can transfer into that four spot. Sadiq Bey takes that three because Sadiq Bey is going to be around, folks. He will. Poddle and Rashawn Holmes have been holding up that center spot while Segundi's Nuts is working his way up. And then you build your team around Luka. And then Zion's going to come back too, so let's not forget that. Who knows about TJ Warren? I'm not even considering him a part of the future necessarily. And Victor too, who knows. But all in all, I'm really excited to see what Elliott can do just the remainder of the season, because he doesn't have a first round pick to fight for or tank for, and so he's just going to be balling out as far as we know. So I think he can do it too, even without Zion at this point.
This is the biggest spoiler, I think, in the league. Elliott has the opportunity to be that, because he is in that really weird spot where he has a very good team. He won the injury bowl for this year, and I don't think it was that close. for a long, long stretch of time, all the way through interleague play. This team was hurt so bad.
I mean, it's just been it's been his stars too. There's nothing you can do about
it. It's really tough. So much production was lost, and you know, a lot of the guys that Elliott rode to that championship run last year, you know, they didn't produce as much as they did last year, which was kind of to be expected, but then that happens on top of all those injuries, and it was just really, really tough. But now, a little bit too late, of course, but people are getting healthier. The stars are coming back. Those were the people that were hurt. And he's found some guys under the radar that are starting to perform in the same way that, you know, someone like Sadiq Bey and Isaiah Stewart did last year. Mm. So I got to play him this week. We're doing the best we can, but yeah, I think Elliott and Graham, welcome, are going to play spoiler big time in Med City.
I think another name that needs to be shouted out is Josh Hart. He's really gone. He's gone completely under the radar this season. The dude was maybe averaging 35 points last year. He's up to 45 this year, and he's been like carrying as much as he can carry this team. He's been carrying it up until this point. So that's really cool to see. Also, Elliott can probably try to flip McCollum for a big, because since Josh Hart is right there backing up Booker already, like, you don't need McCollum, and he's been very inactive for you, but he's another guy that you can, another team can rely on 50 points from McCollum, but he doesn't have the dual eligibility, and you don't really want Booker backing up Luka at the one. That's just too much. That's too much loaded talent at the top. So for Elliott, looking for a big going forward, but otherwise, he's in good shape as well.
It's
so
coming back.
Not too worried about that. And we're going to move on to the Stephen A. Fighting Kwames, who are the only team in this bottom four that has still not been mathematically eliminated from the postseason. Although it was very damn close. Dylan, we're all cheering for you.
We are saying there's a chance.
One in a million. We'd love to see it. But Dylan has made a couple other moves this year. You can ask Dylan what he thinks about him. I'm not sure if he thinks that he won those deals or not yet, but the biggest one by far was trading away Wendell Carter Jr. for Terrence Mann and Lonnie Walker the fourth. And I love me some Terrence Mann. I really do. But both of those young guys definitely had some upside, and I would argue that Wendell Carter probably had more of it. And I'm not sure if the trade value came back for what he wanted. He could have probably gotten a pick out of it too. And when we talk about the three, it's the weakest spot. Terrence is a pure three. And so if he turns into one of those top end threes, even a middle of the road three,
that's huge.
That'd be great. But that's a big question mark. And even then, he's got Deshaun Tate, who's already kind of filling in that spot for him, and rising through the ranks. So other than that, though, Dylan has the top talent on this team. He's got Ice Trey, he's got Shea, he's got John Collins, he's got Jared Allen. All of those guys look great. They're young. They're less than 20. All of them are less than 24 years old. And so that part isn't very concerning for me. It's just everyone else that comes after that, because Dylan loves his team and I don't fault him for it, but like, you just can't win when your secondary players are not even in the top 20 of each position. And so that's going to be a problem that Dylan will have to address going forward. He does have two first round picks this year. And there's a lot of really fun guys on this team. But it's not going to happen this year. And some major changes are going to have to be made to be competitive next year.
Mm-hmm. He is the best basketball player in the league, or maybe Tony Seola. I would love to see the one-on-one between Tony and Dylan.
There would be a lot of good one-on-one matchups with Dylan in this league. But by far the guy that's played the most basketball, oh, I guess Tony has, but of Med City, Dylan's played the most basketball.
And there's a lot of people on this team that are kind of melded in the form of, you know, a young Dylan Hilliker, who was a big body center. He was a big guy, and I think he likes having those big guys on his team. And I mean, the low block for the Fighting Kwames is just incredible, with Collins, Allen, Robert Williams, Nick Claxton. We love us some Nick Claxton in this household. Just traded them Naz Reid. You do love to see. Chris Boucher is back. I mean, these are a lot of good guys that know how to go up and get some boards. This team is super young. We knew that this year was going to be another, you know, stepping stone, not a rebuilding year necessarily, but building on to what was created last year.
I mean, he has gotten more wins than he did last year already. So.
And it's a better team. The team is more competitive this year. He set himself up well to make a move next year. I think Dylan needs to try and go for it next year. Year three is the year to make it happen. I would hope. My fingers are crossed for him. Go get a small forward. in the draft maybe and trade another pick or do something. I don't know. You got to make one move. You can make one move and do it well. I think the Kwames could make some more noise than they have.
I think the biggest way that Dylan can improve his team is really doing well in the draft. Not the rookie draft, but the redraft, the free agent draft that Absolutely. We have at the beginning of the year, because that's where you're going to find a lot of those middle-of-the-road guys. Dylan has all the green he needs. He doesn't have any yellow. There's no yellow. There's nothing in between those green and red guys, and that's the thing that's going to keep him from being able to win, because there's just not enough points to back up the guys that carry you. And especially if those guys are hurt, you got to have the depth. And so I know Dylan knows, and so we're not going to tell him anymore. But that is all you have for your bottom four. We spent a lot of time talking about that already and explaining just how the depth charts work.
Playoffs.
Let's dive into the bottom half of playoffs. All right. Now that we've given our flowers, I think the fun stuff is really about to kick off. We're about to hurt a lot of playoff teams' feelings by breaking down just how we feel about them. So these next four teams are your 7-5 teams. And here they are right here. Your number 4, 7-5 team is the Freak on the Sheets. Your number 3, 7-5 team is the Washington Football Team. Put some respect on their name. The number 2 team is my and Asha's Destroyers.
And
Asha. Welcome. Yes. And the number 1, 7-5 team, in my eyes, overall, the Minneapolis Riots with Jack and Breyer. What they have done in Minneapolis deserves to be number 1 at this point for 7-5. So, James, any brush strokes?
I mean, this is, I think, the most intriguing group of four of the bunch.
I would
because
agree.
There are teams that are going way up. There are teams that are going way down. We have the previous champion here. We have the team that was 12th last year that's here. We have the preseason champion that was here. And then we have Lucas and Robert. So I'm really excited to talk about these four teams because I think they all have like super compelling stories, as compelling as fantasy basketball teams can be in terms of their stories. But these are some really, really fun basketball squads to take a look at.
So we're going to dive right into it. We're going to start with that number 4 team on the list, the Freak on the Sheets. Here are my notes on them. I think, they're very clearly, they're big three. They're big. They're big man heavy.
Massive
three. Massive three out there in the 4 or 5 spots. And they're still waiting on their younger talent to improve. They got the Jordan Poole. They got Gary Trent Jr. Gary Trent's a little bit farther developed, but Jordan Poole especially, Keldon Johnson. And we're still waiting on to see what Marvin Bagley can do full time. Onyeka Okongwu is a very, very intriguing guy. 3rd overall pick just a couple years ago. So he's going to be but another big guy, you know. So you wonder what you're going to do with him. Tree Man, Killian Hayes, Isaac Okoro, Jaden McDaniels, a bunch of guys that they're just young. They're still on developing teams in the NBA. And we still don't know what they can fully do. And then I think the guards are the biggest problem. And especially now this season, you want to try to win right now. And you want to try to win with Jordan Poole. And with Klay coming back, the productivity was already going down for Jordan. And I'm not sure if it's going to get... It's definitely not going to skyrocket now that Klay's back. And I can't imagine it's going to stay the same either. I would have to think it's going to keep kind of going down. He was a 40-point guy. Now he's a 35-point guy. So... the guards are a big problem. Mitchell can only play either point guard or shooting guard. He can't play both. Good young talent. The biggest question marks is also your young power forwards. Obviously, the big guys aren't a problem, but you're the guys that you've been stashing away for quite some time. And Jonathan Isaac, DeAndre Hunter, and Marvin Bagley, all three of those guys are just like, those are the biggest toss-ups in the air I could possibly think of as far as guys to take bets on, to take flyers on. I had DeAndre Hunter. I loved him, but he hasn't seen the court at all this year. Neither has Jonathan Isaac, and Marvin Bagley is
he already wants
wearing
that.
A bag. I don't know. Like, yeah, he's so. I think Marvin's the most top side out of all of those guys. But it isn't the prettiest depth chart. There's not a lot of green. There's a lot of good yellow. But there's also a lot of guys in that bottom box down there, and it's not going to help them win right now, which I know they want to be competitive, but I just don't really see it this year.
The deal is with the green, especially with those guys in the top right, that green is like a forest green. Those are two of the top five scorers in the league so far this year.
It's as green as you can get, but Embiid's not going to be green if he's not on the court either.
Right. And we know, remember last year, like when the bubble reports were even first starting, you know, when I was like writing things, that team was known as McPick 2 at the time, you know, and they were 8-3.
Mm-hmm.
This team is incredibly streaky and has proven it once again this year. It doesn't matter what the name is, doesn't matter the decision that they make.
They were
7-2.
7-2. They were 7-2 at one point. They were performing below the league average in points. So now they've reality has caught up to them. Again, I will say again, they're riding a 3-game losing streak right now, so it's not great. But this is their key players. And it should come at no surprise. It's their big three. It's Embiid, it's Giannis, and it's Mobley. And it's in that order. And I'll tell you why. Because Embiid, they have to have him. He plays on the off days. He fills in that center gap for him. I know Mobley he's playing really well, but Embiid, you literally miss out on 200 points if he's not healthy, because there's no one else that can play the spot other than him on the days that he plays. Again, it's a jigsaw puzzle for you guys. So, I mean, like, if it's in place, you can compete. If Embiid's not there, you're done. I don't care what Giannis does. He can't do it. And if Giannis isn't there, then you can't compete either. So that's why he's number two. And Mobley, he's there at number three because he really brings those three guys together. You do have versatility with him. Donovan Mitchell obviously gets a huge shout-out. But I would say the biggest sleeper on your team that needs to improve, especially, is, of course, Jordan Poole. Without him being able to fill in at least one of those guard spots for you on a regular basis, that's also going to be a problem. But those are the four guys, really. Those are the four guys that you have to look out for, and those are going to be the difference makers. So I'm going to give key players and a sleeper for every team, but that's for the freak.
Last thing for me on the freak, when Giannis and Embiid are both doing their thing and are playing up to like their star potential, this fantasy basketball team can beat almost anybody in the league. On any given week, the freak can beat anybody.
They are the managers of the year. I keep saying it. There's time for someone to catch them, honestly, because Gavin's right behind them. Mm-hmm. But like, these guys are only in the position that they are now because of their managing. So to your point,
I don't think this is a championship roster necessarily.
No, it's not.
Can you win three playoff rounds in a row over 6 weeks? I don't see it with as streaky as this team is. But I would not be shocked to see a like major, massive upset if both Giannis and Embiid go crazy and like all those guys. If everyone in green goes nuts, which we know they have the potential to do, that could happen. I just don't see that happening for six consecutive weeks.
Mm-hmm. And they will. I think they'll end up as the eights. We'll get into that later. Yeah. But I think they'll end up. There's going to be a James Brother matchup again. Anyway, moving on. We go to the football team now. Man, all right, let me pull up my notes for this one. Big wild card, man. This team,
what else is new?
This team changes week to week and day to day. You don't know what you're going to get out of the football team. Joker is the centerpiece, obviously, literally and figuratively. The point guards are pure point guards. They're all pure point guards. So if we pull up the chart right here, yeah, you see the two Ball brothers and then Derrick Rose, who's been out on injury for a while. But all of those guys are pure point guards, so you can't move them around all too much. The only guy that you can is Kyrie. But the problem with that is that Kyrie needs to play that two spot if he does play, because Ant needs to play that three spot because of the guys that are backing Ant up. Michael Bridges is good. Michael Porter Jr. is not there. Dorian Finney-Smith, like all of those guys in yellow can fill in for Andrew at that three spot, but his best team has Ant at the three and Kyrie at the two, and that's what he needs to win. So if Kyrie can come back full time, he's got a good chance at it. There's a lot of good power forward and center talent here, obviously centered around Joker, Miles Turner, Montrezl Harrell. All those guys can play the four as well, other than Joker, but your three key players for Andrew should come at no surprise for this one either. Joker's your number one. If you don't have the guy that averages 86 points a game starting for you every game, it's going to be tough. But we've seen Andrew win without Joker so far. So I think a close second, honestly, is Ant, because of the reason. Like, if Ant isn't playing the three, he's playing the two. And if he can't play the two because he's hurt, Buddy Hield has been a huge disappointment this year. He's the only guy backing him up, because there's not a single guy in that one spot that can come over and play the two for him. And there's not a single guy in the three spot that can come over and play the two for him. It's Ant. It is Ant and Kyrie. And you need both those two guys. So that's the two and three guys on Andrew's team, is Ant and Kyrie. And then his sleeper is Buddy Hield, because if neither of those two guys can be there, Buddy has to up his game big time. Like, start being a 40-point scorer again. hit the threes that we know you can hit. Because otherwise, even with Joker, I don't know how far this team can make it without them.
I think another key player that, I mean, obviously you've looked at this entire roster, Colin Sexton.
Yeah, I mean, like,
would be huge. I don't know when he's coming back. I don't know what he's hurt with or whatever. But if he comes back and is a contributor at that shooting guard spot, that would be an absolute boon for the football team. It would completely change the game for this roster.
It would be great. I just have no clue what to expect because Darius Garland has been running the show for them. And, of course, Ricky Rubio's not there anymore, so he would fill in what Ricky was doing. And we can expect that maybe if he does that, he'd be a 40-point scorer, which would be exactly what he needs because he can play that 1-2. Whether he comes back or not, we don't know, though, and I'm not going to bank on him. There's just a lot of question marks with this team. We just don't know who's going to be there come playoff time, but the talent's there. They're the preseason favorite. You don't want to play them, but you can feel okay about playing them, I guess.
Ligma's got to start working on that plant-based vaccine, man. Get that out.
Kyrie's got to come back. All right, we're moving on to my Destroyers, I believe. Yeah. Yep. All right, well, let's get this over with. So this team is centered around our centers, Kat and Vucevic. They both averaged 60 points for me. They were averaging 70 points for me last year. They are going to be the reason why, if I'm going to win again, I'll get there on their backs. I'm abundant in shooting guard. I have 10 shooting guards, and that was after I traded away a couple of them. Most of my attention is given to the 3-4 spot. I kind of make fun of James in baseball for having dirty laundry as a pitching staff. This is where my dirty laundry comes from. It's like kind of clean, dirty laundry. Like I got a bunch of like yellow, reddish guys filling out the spot there. Like Marcus Morris, LaMarcus Aldridge, PJ Washington. So a couple old guys and a youngin' kind of rounding out that position. The biggest concern going into this postseason is my secondary point guard performance. I need Tyrese Maxey to keep playing like he can average 40 points a game. Otherwise, I'm going to have to move everyone over. And I don't know if Jimmy's going to be there or not. I'm the deepest team in spam down concerning bench players, but it will come down to my star talent, whether I can win or not. My three biggest players are the guys that I picked up from trades this year. In this order, Jimmy Butler, Julius Randle, and CP3, those are my biggest guys. Jimmy's got to be healthy. If he's not healthy, my team is not nearly as good as they can be. Julius, like, if he's not healthy, then I don't have a top-end power forward at all. And there's no one that can fill in that spot from the three or the five. So that would be a huge loss. And then Chris Paul, because if he's not there, then Fred moves over, and then Jimmy would have to move over, and then everything just gets shaken up if any of those guys are gone.
You're just trusting someone you don't want to have to trust to that level.
Exactly. And the guy that would be able to fix all that for me if one person goes down is Desmond Bane, and that's why he's my sleeper pick. He's already averaging like 44 points now.
He's insane.
He's doing exactly what I expected him to do. I'm not going to lie, but like it's just very nice to see, and especially like in that position where I really needed him at that 2-3 spot.
Yeah.
So he is the guy that really can be a difference maker for this team. But then we have the best team of the 7-5s. It's the Minneapolis Riots.
I'm going to say anything about the Destroyers.
Oh, shit. Well, yeah. My bad. I wanted
something to
move on quick enough. All right.
All right. I'll keep it brief. We talk about our teams often, of course. It's a house with a lot of fancy stuff going on. And you touched on it. So, I mean, the X factors are all these guys. Like, you were the most active guy at the trade deadline. Mm. And, I mean, working up to it. So I think, you know, a huge, huge X factor, which we really don't know yet, is how the roster is going to shake out and how it all kind of meshes together. Because a lot of the guys you've traded for have immediately gotten hurt on some bad luck shit.
I knew Jimmy was going to do that, too. He was healthy all year until I picked him up.
The biggest X factor of the whole thing, you have a new owner who has the best luck with basketball I've ever seen in my life. So if the Destroyers end up making it happen, you heard it here first. It's not because of shit. No, it's no way. He didn't do any of it. This is all Asha.
Oh, yeah.
Put the ring on it. Mm. Put the crown on. It's Asha.
Yeah, it will be. It will be.
That's my story. I'm sticking to it.
Thank you. Good input. So the Minneapolis Riots are the ones that round out this list. I don't disagree, though. I really don't. The perfect ice cream sandwich is what this team's depth chart looks like. The most versatile, the most balanced, and the most approved team is the Minneapolis Riots. Tons of players that you can slide into that three spot, which is awesome because they're coming from the other sides of that three spot, obviously. I mean, look at this. You got Jason Tatum, Kelly Oubre Jr., Royce Lewis, Jaylen Brown, all of those guys, Caris LeVert, all of those guys just slide into that three spot, and all of them are above league average in every way as far as that position goes. So that's Jack's. Jack, it goes completely against what I think is the strategy of doing the barbell approach of getting your talent on the outsides. He went right to the middle. All of his talent rests in that middle. He doesn't have the best point guards, but they're consistent, and there's a lot of them in the same way that who else is like that? Kind of the Muppets are kind of like that. But yeah, the biggest concern talent-wise is that point guard spot. The biggest concern depth-wise is that center spot. Nothing flows down. It only flows up. And so if Pascal Siakam goes down, I trust Wendell Carter, but I don't. He's it. That's it. They're not going to get any other center productivity outside of that if Siakam goes down, which we've seen before. So, again, middle heavy. He's defying the odds with the point guard center priority. But this is a team that has been red hot, and the biggest takeaway for me has been the fact that three or four of the players on this team have improved their average points scored by at least 5 points over the course of this last month. Like Tyrese Halliburton, Jaylen Brown, Caris LeVert, and Pascal Siakam, and even D'Lo, all of those guys have improved by half of a dozen points in just the last month, and that's why they're going on this tear. It's not a fluke. They're going off, and there's no slowing down. And so their key players are Siakam, Jaylen, and Halliburton. It's that simple. Like, if those guys can keep doing what they're doing, they're going to be just fine. And then Caris LeVert is that wild card just because he is backing up Miles Bridges, and he can go back and forth between Jason Tatum for that 3-4 spot. God damn, it's just an embarrassment. Like, if you need a 3-4, go consult this team, because they're just, oh my God, it's incredible. It really is.
And what I do have to say about the Riots, they've built their team on depth. I mean, that's what makes this team go, and that's why they've kind of kicked into another gear, mm-hmm. a gear that we didn't know really any team could really have to this extent.
No, I mean, I thought they were going to improve. I didn't think I'd see it in live time like this. It's like watching grass grow at like three clippings a minute.
The only way it works, though, is if you have managers that stay up to date on that shit and make sure you're getting points from these guys every single day. It takes diligence. Mm-hmm. That is not something I think that over on Med City that we thought we'd really ever see from the Minneapolis Riots. So shout out Briar Flanders, bro. Shout out.
Take his goddamn hand, Jack.
Way to take a team that, I mean, Jack drafted a good team. We knew this. We all knew this. And Briar needed to come in and actually make it happen. And he has. And look at what this team is doing. I don't know if we're going to get a little bit of a fall off. I don't know if this is completely sustainable from these guys, because like I look at it, and who's a star? It's Jason Tatum, it's Siakam, it's Jaylen Brown, and then after that, we'll see. But it's young, they're deep, they're really good. I would expect that they're not going to go back to what they were at the beginning of the season, which was like a 7-8. But we'll see if this is the peak or if they just keep going like this. And if it's the second one, fucking watch out.
This team reminds me a lot of what my team was last year, just because I rode my team on a bunch of good players on bad teams. You know, Wendell Carter Jr., you have the Magic Center, just like I did last year. You have Pascal Siakam, who's basically a cat on the Raptors. The only difference is your point guards, because you put all your talent in the four. I put all my talent in the one, but very similar styles of players on this team as I see the last team. So I do think that you can keep it up, and I'm terrified to play you in the playoffs if it comes down to it. So
please go listen to Miles Bridges' rap song. Please. I'm begging you, anyone who's watching this, please go listen to Miles Bridges' rap.
I'll go listen to it. I don't know. I don't know any better. But that's it for your middle four. So we're on to the top four now. And then there are four. Here are your top four teams currently at 9-3. At number four, we have the valiant Boston Fat Old Men. At number three, we have the tenacious Mason City Muppets. At number two, we have the big San Antonio Women. And at number one, the Grand Meadow Golden Geese.
Cheers, brothers. Fly it, baby.
All right, well, James, any just opening thoughts?
Man, I'm really glad that I'm in this group, because you look at the other three teams in this group and they're all fantastic. I look at the fat old men are there. The fat old men are there.
Undefeated and in interleague play. In interleague play.
It really has not, like, undefeated. That's beating me.
And Gavin.
That's the biggest thing. I really have, like, the entire season have not been able to wrap my head around it. And shout out Tony, shout out Jordan. Well, I will give you as many flowers as you'd like and as that you deserve, which is like the whole fucking bouquet of them for what you've done with this team. But I look at it and I see championship contender, championship contender, championship contender, and the fat old men. But you're also a championship contender. You see what I'm saying? Like, it's just, you build something up from last year. You build an idea of this team in your head, and then it just, like, is not computing. You've literally broken my brain.
Well, we're going to start with those fat old men right away. And so let's jump right into it. This is a bit of a, it's not the prettiest assortment of talent, honestly, as far as how the depth chart looks. But it's still very top heavy, no doubt. The biggest weakness on this team is still the point guard and shooting guard spots. There's no flexibility. All of their point guards are pure point guards, and they have five of them, and they're all pure point guards. God. The only two shooting guards, they only have two shooting guards in the top 36. That's also a problem that they'll probably have to kind of deal with at this point, because you're not just going to pick one up off of waivers. All of the small forward and power forwards, all of their small forwards are power forwards, which is very useful, especially with AD out. We don't know when he's going to come back, but we need some breaks to outperform the other top three in this group. But the top end talent is there. I mean, you look at across the board, from Bradley Beal to Brandon Ingram to Anthony Davis to Rudy Gobert. All four of those guys are in the top six of their position. Yeah. And a lot of the times that's all it takes, because you do have a lot of yellow to back them up after that. And so my key players for this team, in this order, Beal. Because if you don't have Beal, you don't have a shooting guard. It's plain and simple. Like, you need him to be healthy. And I know that Beal's kind of touch and go right now with some problems with his legs, I think. I'm not really sure what he has an issue with, but has to be there, even more than AD does, and he's your second guy. Because if AD's not there, you have plenty of power forwards to back him up. You can move Ingram into that three spot. You can move Markkanen up. Like, there's a lot you can do. You can move Portis into that four spot. You can deal with not having AD, but if you want a chance to win, you need AD. And then finally, De'Aaron Fox, the guy you traded another elite power forward to get to try to fill in that point guard spot for you. So your team is a lot better than even at the beginning of the season was by getting De'Aaron Fox. But he needs to keep performing at least a 45 point clip. Otherwise, Jalen Brunson is your sleeper. And the reason why I haven't your sleeper isn't because I think he can pop off. It's that we need him to be able to just maintain that 40 points, because now that Luke is back and the Mavs are competing, we don't know what Brunson's productivity is going to be. I trust Brunson. I love Brunson as a player, but I just don't know what his fantasy asset's going to be going forward. And so he's definitely your sleeper. But anyway, that's kind of my thoughts on this team.
I mean, again, off the top, flowers to Tony and Jordan, because another team like the Riots, and we knew this going in, you know, the top end talent has always been there. It's just been a matter of when do they play? How can we get a rotation going? And maybe the third manager could be the computer, because right at the very end of the draft, when nobody from the fat old men was in the lobby, the final two picks of the free agent draft were Ivica Zubac and Jalen Brunson. First off, two former Grand Meadow Golden Geese that I should have kept.
Kevin Love
team.
Was also an auto draft in that.
Three of them. Oh my God.
Kevin Love, Danilo Gallinari.
Jesus Christ.
They raked in right at the
Larry
end.
Larry Nance.
Yeah, all five of those guys.
Oh my God. Yep. So yeah, it definitely is the computer, because now look at all the guys that have turned into like key rotation pieces. Jalen Brunson specifically, Zubac specifically, just because I knew those guys and really shouldn't have let them go in the first place. But here they are. Glad to see them performing on a team that deserves to be good. Also, Flowers, too. Are you fucking kidding me? Bobby Portis puts up 48 a night now.
Bobby's been doing this since last year. They picked him up last year. Oh, my God. Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God. I mean, I love it. I love it. He's the guy the Bucks need. He's the guy the fat old men need. It's just incredible. Anthony Davis isn't even playing right now. He's been out for a long time. When he comes back, this team could get even better.
They've been on their 8-game win streak without Anthony Davis. This team is legit, without Anthony Davis.
You do have to stay a little bit lucky, though, because, like she said, if there are major injuries coming down at a bad time, or even issues with COVID, you know, at the wrong time, it could doom this team in ways that you don't want to see.
If I could interject, too, I mean, one of the guys that's not even on the key players that I mentioned, but is arguably an MVP candidate, and without him, you're losing by a lot this week, is Rudy Gobert. I mean, like, without Rudy, you do have Bobby, but Rudy... Without Rudy, you would still have Bobby and AD if AD came back. But Rudy's really been a top five center this entire year. Yeah. And so that's a huge loss if you can't get him back. I think he'll be back. It shouldn't be a problem. But a blocking machine. I mean, Rudy gets you 4 points. He gets like 20 points off of blocks every game. So
there's a lot of teams that are championship caliber at this point in the video. And the Fat Old Men are definitely one of them. I would not be surprised to see them catch a heater and go out and make a deep run.
Mm-hmm. Moving on to the number three team, I'm going to assume he's probably a little bit upset he's only at number three, but right now, he's the three. The Mason City Muppets, Gavin Sparks, and Katie. This is the deepest team in Med City, and they have a near-perfect depth chart. When you look at it, you see the depth in the point guard, you see the depth at the center, you have everything working around it. Only four players aren't on the top 36 in each position for this team, and all of them are just place fillers off of waivers. And so the roster is guard heavy, and it flows down to the big men. The power forward is by far the weakest position on this team, and it's probably the weakest position on any team. There's only four power forwards on this entire team. The top two power forwards are naturally small forwards, and so that's another thing that you don't want to see, and that was actually due to the trade that me and Gavin made. Mm-hmm. And I know why Gavin made it, because he traded Julius Randle, who's a pure power forward, for Tobias Harris, and he sacrificed a little bit of points for the flexibility of being able to put Tobias at that three spot in case Paul George doesn't come back, and then he could slide Porzingis into that four spot. So but if you don't have Ayton, you can't move Porzingis there either. So the only noticeable flaw is that both of his shooting guard and power forward are natural small forwards. But if PG is out, all that talent can just slide into that three spot. So it's not that big of an issue. You're going to be able to fill your roster spots, which is the biggest part of the playoffs, just being able to fill your roster spots. I don't see a problem with this team as far as doing that. It's just a matter of you're not going to get the same production out of Chris Middleton as you did last year. Tobias Harris is... Yeah, he's streaky. He's streaky. And so Porzingis needs to stay healthy. Paul George needs to come back. And Cole Anthony just keep pumping out 50 points. And the Muppets are looking good. But there are a few weaknesses that you could see, just kind of the same things as last year. Injuries can bite this team.
Mm-hmm. I don't think they're, you know, the runaway number one favorite team. Like, we kind of got the vibe last year that it was that way, and then they got really hurt at the wrong time. They are one of the best teams in the league. They're not necessarily like in a tier by themselves and everyone else, like we kind of thought last year.
Mm-hmm. They are point guard heavy, which is why I think my biggest key player for this team is Kristaps Porzingis, because if he goes down, that really locks everyone into their place. You can't move Tobias Harris from that four spot. He's locked into that four. And then if Paul George is out, Chris Middleton comes into the three, Malcolm Brogdon moves to the two, and Cole Anthony's your one, and that's all you can do if Porzingis is out. That's it. And so Porzingis is the biggest key on this team as far as I see it, especially with the production he's having this year. Paul George is a close second. I think you can live without Paul George, but he puts your team over the top if you have him, mm-hmm. without a doubt. When you have a guy that averages 60 points a game playing in that three spot, that's nice. And then Garland is your number three guy, I think, because if you do have to move some players around, Garland can rise up and be either your one or two. And the way he's been playing this year, I think he deserves an all-star. spot unless it's taken away from Fred VanVleet. But I think Garland is another key player on this team. And then your sleeper is Franz Wagner. And I don't think I have to explain that. He fits into that 3-4 spot for you. And if he can continue playing like he has been, you can just plug and chug. And you don't really have to worry about too much. Nope. Yeah. Any further thoughts, or?
I still think that, you know, from draft day, from day one, the Muppets just kind of seemed like a team that was in a class of their own. And throughout the past 24 months or however long it's been, I feel like everyone else has been slowly kind of catching up to where Gavin has been at. Would I have made the Tobias for Randall trade? I don't know, because I just like Randall more than I do Tobias. That's a personal thing. But I do get the flexibility, especially with Paul George still out. It comes down to injuries. Like, if this team, and injuries are an X factor for literally everybody. I can make out a storyline for everyone. Are people going to stay healthy at the right time? Like, that's what it's about.
It's just part of the way that you have to strategize your team too, is knowing a guy is injury prone or not and taking that risk. Christian McCaffrey over here for instance. But we due to time, I do want to move on because we do have a lot more to talk about.
You're a good team, Gavin. You know that. You don't need to tell
the
you that.
Second team on this list is the Big San Antonio Women. And this is another near perfect depth chart. Two top point guards and two top centers. The only fix you could possibly make to this team, really, is swapping Rozier for like an RJ Barrett or a Kelly Oubre to fill in that secondary three spot. But even then, Rozier still gives you a great utility role. And dual eligibility at that guard spot for Al. So, you could, but you don't have to move him. So, Al, and you can't anymore anyway. So, Al has a ton of centers. He has a ton of centers. Only Dylan has the same number of centers as Al, and it's 7. They lead the league in centers. Wow. So, if you need a center, I wouldn't say that they're the greatest centers in the world after those top two, but Mason Plumlee might be on the block, I guess.
They are big.
Al's just a black hole of centers over there. Also, Al is the only team in Swaghouse Bubble with more players in each position than the league average. So every single position, he has players that are, like, you see those bolded numbers. So, like, it's point guard equals 6, shooting guard equals 8. If it's bolded, it means that that team has more than the league average in that position. And so Al has more than league average in every single position, which is nice. He's very versatile. But outside of his centers, Otto Porter Jr. is the only player without dual eligibility.
That's incredible.
Only player. So really, for Al, I don't think I have too much else to say. I think this team is the most primed to make a championship run. I think you have, I mean, you look straight across the board. DeJounte Murray, James Harden, KD, Scottie Barnes, Jonas Valanciunas. I mean, those guys have been and continue to be reliable. I think his biggest key player is KD. Because if you don't have KD, then everything starts getting moved around. You don't have anyone behind KD to take in that natural three spot. And so Scottie Barnes would have to move over. And then you don't have anyone at the four spot. And so KD really is the biggest loss if you lose him. Because there's no one that can really just take over his spot. And second behind him is Scottie Barnes, because there's no one that can take over his spot either. And so aside from that, DeJounte Murray, just because he's averaging 70 points a game this year.
It's incredible.
So, and he's paid $3 for him. So even without DeJounte, Drew Holiday slides in there, James Harden can move over. But everyone about this team has their place, and as long as they stay healthy, I think they do make it to the championship. I don't think anyone can beat them if this team is healthy. But if someone does get hurt, let's hope it's a guard, because Seth Curry's been fucking on fire, and he can slide up into that two spot for you, and I would feel comfortable having Seth Curry there. So he's your sleeper. James, any thoughts?
I think, will this team win a playoff round? I mean, you would definitely expect it. You would expect this team to make a deep run, for sure. Just the way it's constructed, the same with Gavin, and hopefully same with the Geese, as we'll talk about. I think those are kind of the three teams that, I mean, from a point scored standpoint and from a roster constructed standpoint, I probably put the Destroyers personally there as a fourth team to expect something out of. But guess what? That's four teams. That's a semifinal right there. Like, you do one playoff round and boom, you're there. So it's going to come down to every single person you're putting in your lineup. It's coming down to knowing, or at least being able to predict, who's going to be the player that's going to go off on a given basis. So I think Al is going to have to really dive into it once the calendar turns even past March to something like April. But you get down to it in those final days, how do you know who's going to go off? And how can you, I mean, it just...
Oh, I think Al knows what he has to do. I mean, it's very clear based on this depth chart who he starts. There's not a toss-up. You know, like, there's a lot of teams like the Kwames who don't know who they should start every day. That's not a problem for Al. You look at this team, you know exactly who you're going to start because the guys after that are not even a question compared to who you could start. You know what I mean? Like, so he's not – I don't think he is going to run into that problem, honestly. He's going to run into maybe some injury problems, and that's the only thing that can slow him down. It's what slowed him down last year. I was terrified to play Al in the first round, but he was banged up. This is the exact same team. He was one of two teams that didn't make a single trade. And so this is the same team as last year, and he's the number one seed right now. And so, no, I'm not worried for Al. If he gets banged up, he gets banged up, but that's just how it is. And that's the risk you take with this kind of a team, because we know that KD's had injury woes like that.
Yeah.
But your number one team is the Grand Meadow Golden Geese. And they have the best small forward in the game. LeBron is a cheat code. He's not just a small forward. He's a damn point guard. He has the arrow, but it just skirts right over shooting guard and goes right to point guard.
Do you know he's playing center for the Lakers now?
I don't need to hear that. He's a one, he's a three, and he's a four. And James's shallowest position is point guard. Hear me out, because...
I actually do agree with that.
He only has 5 point guards, but three of those 5 point guards are Ja, Westbrook, and LeBron, with like Dinwiddie just standing by in case they need him. And so it's very deep. It's the deepest position on this team, but it's the shallowest position on this team because they're pure too. Like those two guards and Westbrook and Morant, you can't move them anywhere else. They can only play point guard. And I know that Morant's going to get the priority. Westbrook, if they play on the same day, maybe slides into the utility at this point. Well, you have to slide into the utility.
Definitely does.
Which helps out. But the big men remain the biggest concern for me about this team. Sabonis ties everything together with Triple J and Horford. They're acting as dual eligibility to kind of switch on and off with. But also LeBron. Let's not forget that LeBron is a four. So LeBron can also slide down into that four spot, and he has Hayward to come up into that three spot. So there's a lot of good balance on this team. There's lots of place fillers who play on off days too. I've said this from the very beginning. This team plays on Sundays.
Yeah.
They play when other teams don't. And the guys that do play on those days are their superstars. They're Westbrook. They're LeBron. They're sometimes Ja. All the guys that you don't want to have to play on those days, they're playing on those days. And that's why I picked this team to win Med City. And so the biggest key players for this team are LeBron. I mean, it's just without a doubt. If you don't have LeBron, we don't talk about the Geese in this way. Mm-hmm. We don't talk about the Geese if LeBron is averaging 65 points. We only talk about the Geese if LeBron's averaging 75 points, like he is, honestly. We don't talk about you the same way. We still talk about you. We don't, like, LeBron is literally just owning this season right now. And after LeBron, it's DeRozan. Because since his two-point guards are pure, they don't slide over. And there's no one to slide over to take that spot from the other side either. So if DeRozan's out, next one in line is Powell. And you've talked about this. You said you needed another shooting guard.
Mm-hmm.
Powell's fine, but if DeRozan goes down, Powell's not DeRozan.
Right.
He's not the alpha dog on the best team in the East. And then your third guy is Ja, because he's performing like 10 points above average from what he was last year. So it's a very clear top three for me in that order, very clearly too. And then your difference maker to me, and maybe you disagree, maybe you don't, I would say it's Al Horford, because you kind of know what you're getting with Jaren at this point, but you don't know what you're going to get with Al going forward. And the biggest reason why the Geese have been equally as terrifying as any other team is because Al Horford has just slidden in and been in a 50-point score for him on days when Sabonis isn't playing or no one else is playing in that spot. He's kind of cooled off a little bit. RW3 has taken some minutes away from him. Mm-hmm. We don't know what direction Boston's going to go in. They could, like, trade Horford away if they don't feel it, really. So that is a bit of a wild card. I think Al Horford could – he's not going to break you, but he could definitely make you, and I think that's why he's your key sleeper.
Yeah, I do think, one, it's a much better constructed roster this year than last year. And last year, we even ran into some major injury problems in the playoffs. It kind of doomed us against Kevin. But two players that sat on my bench the entire season that are now back and becoming, they became difference makers, Spencer Dinwiddie, Jaren Jackson. So right away, I mean, we sat in this room and said that the Geese were about to blow it up if it didn't go well because everyone was old. And then the three guys you said were keys, LeBron, DeMar, and Ja Morant, are three of the top like five guys in the MVP race right now. It's yeah, everything I mean, like, has like worked out better than we ever could have predicted. Period.
It's no surprise why this team is performing the way they are. You look at who's on this team. You might not think that they would have been that great any other year going up to this point, but like it's the perfect storm right now.
It is.
It really is literally the perfect storm. Like you couldn't imagine it happening any other way. Other than them being first place with the guys that they have on their team. So
I can't help but think part of the reason why I was doing so well just a few weeks ago was because my team had like a COVID bubble around it. Which
this team hasn't
COVID
been hurt either. Yeah, they've been while they've been. Yeah, I mean, he didn't need to score 2,100 points against Hunter either, but he did.
Yeah.
So
what I'm saying is it comes for everybody. And I know my brain.
Well, you've done this last
year
too. We've seen the Geese go through the same motions. It just didn't work out for them last year. So
right,
it's so much a matter of timing. There's nothing that you can. There's not. That's completely out of your control if it happens. And at this point, there's no trades to make either.
No.
So
we
you
put
know,
the squad together.
James is going to be on the waiver wire, being annoying as hell, and just
not
doing
in
that.
Basketball.
So
not
yeah,
in
you are
basketball. I'm not annoying.
All right.
Basketball.
Well, we're done talking about it. We're going to move on, and we're going to get to the playoff matchups because if I picked everyone kind of to I foresaw who's going to win how many games or whatever. So I have every single team in Spam Town outside of the Ghost of Simmons going 3-2 in divisional play. And that's how I think it's going to shake out. There's not going to be any change in the standings. I think Jack is actually going to leapfrog me and become the 5 seed. And so I'll become the 6. And so in Med City, I have the Geese and the Muppets going 4-1. The Fire Nation is 3-2. And the Freak and Stephen A go 2-3 with the Hermantown Heroes going 0-5. And so how this shakes out then is the Geese end up as the 1 seed. I think they get the tiebreaker over Gavin. And they play the Freak in the first round. And I don't think that will be a contest. I think the Geese will just walk through. And so they will get the winner of the Fat Old Men and the Riots.
God, what a game.
What a game.
Oh, my God.
Without thinking, I'm just going to say the Riots. I think the Riots are the better team, and I think they're the team that if they do get through that first round, they are the ones that have the best shot of taking down the Geese. I think if the Fat Old Men get through, they deserve it, but I don't think that they are capable of taking down the Geese the way they're formatted right now. I think the Riots are the team that have a chance to take down the Geese.
If it's Geese-Riots second round, it's not happening. If it's almost anybody else in the second round, I would be like, all right, yeah, let's go. If it's Geese Rides, there's no way I win. No chance.
Not after the disrespect.
No chance. No chance. Now, if it's the championship, we're going to go back to the Swag House Bubble preview when I said, what about Geese Rides? And everyone laughed, and then we cut it to black. And now here we are.
And then I'll look like the fool.
Yeah, let's go.
That's possible. If the Geese end up as the 6th seed and then walk through on the other side of the bracket, if the Riots end up as the 6th seed and then go through the other side of the bracket, mm-hmm. Very possible. Very possible. The 3-6 matchup would be me and Gavin.
Holy,
tell me you wouldn't want to see that.
Oh, my God.
That would be entertaining. I wouldn't even know. I think I'd take myself, but that would literally come down to just who is there, who's healthy, who's available. And production-wise, I think my team is better than Gavin's right now if we're all healthy and we can just roll with it. If each team can just roll with it, I think I can get them. But who knows? Who knows in that matchup? I respect the Muppets. I really do respect the Muppets. And then your 2-7, another great game, the women in the football team. And I know Andrew said he would love to take on Al. No.
You don't.
You don't want to take on Al. Al is going to use whoever he faces in the first round as a doormat. He's going to walk forward. And so your semifinal would essentially look like, in my eyes, the Geese versus the Riots and the Destroyers / the Muppets versus the women. And if that's your final four, folks, what more could you ask for?
I mean, there's 6 or 7 championship contenders.
I'm not even going to try to pick. I'm not going to try to pick a winner after that because that's just any four of those teams could run away with it. I know for a fact that my team, if we can get past the second round and into the finals, I'm going to win. I've already seen what my team looks like in that final week. If we can survive that second round of playoffs, I feel pretty good about it. Getting past the second round of playoffs is going to be tough for me. So I will pick a final, though. I think it will be the conference winners. I think it's going to be the Geese, and I think it's going to be the women. That's just the most clear...
I welcome it.
That's the most clear choice and prediction to me right now. But who knows? I really... Like, no one knows. No one knows. And I look forward to the weeks to come, because there's a lot that's going to shake out just in these last 5 weeks of the regular season. Yeah. James, any final thoughts? Because I know that we're doing atrocious on time, and
hey,
we appreciate everyone for sticking through us. And
it's what happens when you get these big heads in the same room. Yeah. But I'm really excited to see the last few weeks of the season play out. Super, super excited for the 2-week playoff matchups. I love the change.
Mm.
Absolutely love it. I think... You know, at the end of this, with the 2-week playoff matchups, that one champion's going to stand, and no one can really say anything about it. Like, that's the best team that year. It was meant to happen that way. With that change, I like it. Mm-hmm. I think half the league, like 6 of 12 teams right now, I think could go into the playoffs and say, I could do this. Maybe even 7. Maybe even 8. Like, shit.
7, you know, for sure. Yeah.
There's 8 teams above 500 right now. They've won more games than they've lost. We'll see what it's like in 5 weeks, but there are a lot of solid squads in this league. I am really, really excited to see how it shakes out. I wish the best of health on everybody, because we don't want it to come down to injuries. We want it to come down to good players playing basketball.
And before we part ways, I'm going to share with you my complete power rankings.
Yes.
It's not broken up into 3 parts, and this is everyone is everywhere. So, at number 12, the Ghost of Simmons. At number 11, the Hermantown Heroes.
Mm-hmm.
At number 10, the Fire Nation of Frederickstad.
Mm-hmm.
At number 9, the Freak on the Sheets. At number 8, we have the Fighting Kwames of Stephen A's. Fighting Kwames. At number 7, we have the Washington Football Team.
Mm-hmm.
At number 6, we have the Boston Fat Old Men. At number 5, we have Donald's Destroyers. At number 4, we have the Mason City Muppets. At number 3, we have the Big San Antonio Women. At number 2, we have the Minneapolis Riots. And at number 1... we have the Grand Meadow Golden Geese. I would like to appreciate and thank everyone for sticking with us and watching all the way through this just monster video where we're just rambling and explaining all the depth chart rules. I'm so sorry, and I hope you understand the arrows and red shit and black shit, whatever. But
it's for the content.
For the content, we thank you for watching, and we will see you next week. Peace.
Wake your punk ass up. It ain't nothing but a Compton thing. Chill. Real simple and plain. We teach you some lessons.